That is 100% Tony Gibson's problem. His fault, his problem. I think our first day that we had our team meeting back 3 weeks ago, it was like 74 degrees in here, and guys came in and they're all, there's like 140 people in here or whatever, and the body heat got this thing cranked up to about 82 real quick, and he started sweating, which when he starts sweating, he gets really grumpy and all that, so he threw a fit, and they got that fixed, so now it's like 40 in here, because he's the one that meets in here. Once we break, the defense stays, and the linebackers stay. Like happening, pretty cool here. Too cold for y'all?
67.
Nah, not bad. It feels cooler than that. Okay, we're in mock week. Obviously been in school for, this is the fourth day. I get this out of the way. I'm not happy about the fact that we get less time to prepare than Tennessee does. They start school 6 days later, or 5 or 6 days later. I think this is a flaw in how the NCAA does their preseason practices. We, you know, they did move it to 25 practices as opposed to 29 practices. We did get some morning walkthroughs with balls, which that was good. It's still, with that said, they still get about 5 more days of unlimited time, which if you add that up, that's probably around an extra week of work. Once we got into the 20-hour rule, they got an extra week of work. So, but nonetheless, we started school when we started school. Don't understand why we start on a Wednesday. That's always kind of baffling me. But guys are in a routine from school. Had a good scrimmage on Saturday. Was very happy with that. Had a really good weekend around here and got a lot of work done. Was very pleased with scrimmage in general. We're still today and tomorrow, monitoring whether there's cells everywhere. That's another annoying part of my job. But we got to get out there and we got to practice today. We got to practice tomorrow. We'll start introducing some, our opponent with Tennessee. I'm not going to talk too much about it until next week with y'all or with our team. We still got battles going on. We still got a lot of assignment, technique, issues, and concerns that we got to continue to address. Figuring out who's going to be on the starting lineups, figuring out special teams lineups. Still got to figure some of that stuff out. So we'll practice hard today and tomorrow to hopefully get a step closer to that. And then we'll get into kind of our mock week. We've talked a lot about the mock week situation since we've been here, and teach them how we do things on Thursday and Friday. We'll travel on Friday. Got a lot of new guys that haven't experienced how we do things on a travel Friday and a game day situation on Saturday. So get a lot of work done when it comes to the logistics on everything for those 3 days. Then we'll get into the actual game week and we'll talk and watch a whole lot of Tennessee stuff starting on Sunday. So that's where we're at currently. Jake Long broke his hand. He'll be out a few months. Hopefully get him back at some point, probably similar to what we got Ferns and Qualls with the timetable. You never know how these guys are going to heal. From a timetable perspective, he's another one that's kind of on the shelf, but we'll get him back at some point this year. Other than that, we're healthy, we're happy, we're good. In a pretty good place. Looking forward to just continuing to move forward to get ourselves ready to play. Questions?
What was pleasing about Saturday's scrimmage?
Overall energy I thought was really good. Sometimes, after you get 2.5 weeks into beating out each other, you kind of get tired of it. You really don't want to do it again. We've had less tackle reps, due to how we're supposed to practice. I think that probably had something to do with it. Less scrimmage reps, less live reps. So I was happy with that. The energy, offense made some plays, defense made some plays. A lot of special teams work. You know, we've been able to go. We're getting after each other on special teams a little bit as well, so that looked pretty clean. You know, had referees here. You know, had an hour meeting prior to that scrimmage on rules changes, which is quite a bit of rules changes this year. So I feel like we understand those rules changes a lot better. They were free to throw flags, and there wasn't a whole lot of flags being thrown. That's always encouraging. You know, the young kids, which the young kid scrimmages, the quote unquote thirds or scout team guys or whatever, however you want to refer to them, I refer to them as developmental guys. You know, they got a bunch of snaps as well. And, our team was excited about watching those guys play. So just the energy was where I wanted it to be. Got a lot of work done as well.
Do you envision having more older players on special teams this year with your depth?
Yeah, it should happen that way. I monitor how many are on what units. We don't have a lot of guys that are on 3 and 4 units. We're able to spread that around a little bit, which our guys are buying into that and they feel good about it.
And that little outbreak you had, has that been cleared up, contained?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, there is some overreaction to it a little bit. It's poison ivy with the fever. I mean, your hands and feet aren't going to fall off. So we had to contain it. It is contagious. So, our medical staff did a great job of identifying it. We clean this place as well as we can possibly clean it, regardless if there's any kind of outbreak or not. But guys were educated on it. I think it probably spooked them more than anything. Just because it's kind of an unknown situation more than anything. But yeah, it's contained. It's more of a nuisance than anything. You got to keep those guys away. So it's we treated it like those guys were hurt and just couldn't come here. Once the doctors cleared them, they were back. It was a nuisance, but it's all good.
You mentioned battles ongoing. Anyone that have been decided?
I'm not prepared to say any of that yet. There have been decisions that have been made, obviously, but we want these guys to keep competing. Not prepared to put a depth chart out yet. I mean, I've made decisions and. Position coaches have made decisions, but I'm not going to tell y'all, and we're probably not going to tell them. In fairness to wanting to continue to create as much competition as we possibly can, I think that's the best approach with our football team. And my job is to get the best players out there and to get them as good as we possibly can get them. So I'm just not prepared to talk about that at this point.
Not with specifics, but just in the process of that, do you have, and I'm obviously you're talking to the assistant coaches, do you all have like a drop-dead date or a meeting where you go down and say, okay, we're picking this guy, or it's too close to call, they're both going to play?
Well, yeah, most of the time it's that. Most of the time it's, okay, you get the starting nod, but, that doesn't mean you're going to play 100% of the time. They're not many of them that are going to play 100%. And then you got to look into it. If it's a situation where it's going to be 50-50, then I make the decision of how many special teams those snaps those guys play as well. So that's an ongoing conversation, and our guys understand that, and their job. I think we're comfortable with Will Greer being the starter. Jack Allison's doing a good job as a backup, but he's got to continue to fight off Trey Lowe, who's going to get better and better and better. Way that position is. just because you start doesn't mean you're playing 100% of the time. And I want our guys to know that and continue to fight hard to try to gain as much playing time as they can. That's their job.
When you look at penalties, if you even look at penalties over the course of the season, do you chalk some up to effort? Do you chalk some up to that technique? Do you even categorize them at all, or you just try to keep them?
Yeah, and I addressed this with our team on Saturday. I was getting a little uncomfortable with our aggressiveness with some holding calls, because because I'm not going to call that. Like, if we're in the course of a practice and it irritates other coaches and other players, if a guy's holding and the running back squirts by him right there, you know, I'm not going to get in the habit of flagging our team throughout the course of practice. It's our assistant coach's job to chalk it up to technique situations. You know, there's some aggressiveness, like fighting for a ball, that can get you a pass interference call. It's up to the assistant coach to determine whether it was reckless, poor technique, that sort of thing. You know, your penalties are never going to be 100% avoidable. With that said, I did remind our team that we were ninth in the Big 12 in penalties last year. And we've been pretty good with penalties around here over the course of my tenure. Last year, I felt like we were a little reckless, and our technique was not quite what it needed to be. So that's been a point of emphasis. And again, I gave the green light to that crew that was here, and I didn't see a whole lot of bad stuff.
Is there one rule change that even concerns you more than others? It doesn't seem like there's a whole lot of big ones.
The chop block, I think, is a big one. I mean, this is like, in my 8 years here, I think six of the years we've talked about blocking below the waist in our head coach meetings. And every year I leave more confused on what's legal and what's not legal. I do know that they're trying to get it out of our game. So there's things that were legal. And we showed them a lot of examples. And the tricky part is we don't practice it. We don't practice cut blocking against our own people. So it's hard to practice it, but we have to educate them. And it's up to each one of the position coaches to communicate to the players, this is an acceptable cut block. This is not an acceptable cut block. And it can go on defense, too. Defense can chop down offensive guys. And we do at times. There's just got to be – they have to understand what is acceptable and what is not, because they're going to look very, very closely on cut blocks, and you're going to see more flags on chop blocks for sure.
In 2012, your team scored the school record points, but you only finished like 7-6 because, you know, you gave up almost as many points. How do you keep that from happening this year? I mean, what are the differences between this year?
I respect the reference, and it's not the first time it's been referenced. We damn sure don't talk about it. I mean, this is a totally different situation. You know, Gibby's been our defensive coordinator with going on 5 years now. We have a lot of continuity with our coaching staff. We have a lot of older players that are experienced Big 12 football players. You can't compare this football team to that football team. You know, you can compare a fifth-year senior quarterback or a senior quarterback and a couple of wideouts that have good numbers, but other than that, the comparison is not there.
Then on the Richard rule, and this may never come up, but if it's a medical and the guy could, let's say he loses 2 years and he can apply for that sixth, could he play in the final four games?
It's a good question, and it's actually been brought up in our conversations, and I don't know if we have a rule to it yet. You know, they're granting 6 years, but we can't go back. And from what my understanding is it's going to get rid of the medical hardship. You know, like if you're, you know, the guys that play in three games and then you say he's hurt, which every coach says they were hurt, and whether they truly were or whether they can come back or whatever it is, that's neither here nor there. But it kind of gets rid of that aspect of it, but that's a different conversation than the sixth year. So I don't know. I don't have an answer for it. I know it's been brought up, and we're kind of looking into it.
The transfer season is been a number that are getting immediate eligibility. I mean, just a traditional transfer, not a grad guy, including one of your old ones. Have you got explanations as to why kids are now getting immediate eligibility as a straight transfer? Because it could apply to you as many transfers as you get.
No. It's going to continue to trend that way. That's every indication is it's going to continue to trend that way. coach across the country wants to talk about. A couple I'd like to get some immediate eligibility with right now. Ain't working for us. I don't know what to go with. You guys are kind of quiet today. We did add a player today. Isaiah Esdale. Interesting story, really. Is an Eastern Christian kid, which I think if you look back at our success rate with Eastern Christian kids, it's been high. So he's a part of all those guys. Knows David, played with David. Was a little younger than like Nikhil Wendell, Kenny, but older than like Letty and Randy. So he was kind of in that area where things kind of shut down, got lost in the shuffle a little bit. Was at Eastern Arizona with the Brown Brothers last year. Brown Brothers are doing good. Eastern Christian kids are doing good. This guy's a pretty thick 3-for-3 guy. So he's on board. He's in school today. So excited to have him here. Other than that, that's about all the news I got.
Dean, what is your roster number now that you can expand on?
I don't know. You know, we put a couple of guys on scholarship. We all know about Evan. A couple guys are still fighting for a few. I don't really know what it is. It doesn't matter. You know, I mean, there's different rules that we can work around. Recruiting's going good. You know, I would imagine if we sign our 25 here, December will be at the full 85. I know we're close to that.
Is Dell eligible this year?
Mm-hmm.
DB? Or?
He's a receiver.
Any other questions?
We'll talk about Tennessee next week. We got work to do on that. See y'all.